Hey everybody, this is Darwin Reina, the Festival Director of Hospitalejo Vega International Film Festival. Today I have a great filmmaker from the US. He's done this great film, Why the Spray. We got Jason. I got so many questions for him. How are you, Jason? Thank you for being with us.
I'm very good, thank you. And thank you for having me.
Jason, let's start first with the, when the idea born in you and you say, hey, I gotta do this. And why? Why was that drive to make this beautiful documentary?
Okay, so I moved to Miami when I was young. When I was a teenager, I should say. It was in the early 90s. And back in the 90s, Miami was a different place than it is today, especially when it came to graffiti. At that point, graffiti was becoming a big nuisance in Miami, and it was everywhere. Everywhere you looked, you would see graffiti on walls and, you know, here, there, and everywhere. And I grew up, and I was a very artistic child. So I always loved to draw, paint, and things of that nature. When I did move to Miami, I went to high school with a lot of graffiti writers because kids, that's what they were doing, you know, at the time. I always found it fascinating, you know, and I tried to do graffiti. I made my own little graffiti name and everything else. I wasn't any good at it. So I said, you know, maybe this is not for me, but I always found it fascinating either way. Fast forward now, you know, quite a few years. We have places in Miami now called like Wynwood, where it is an art district where, you know, they make it like an open air museum for people to paint on walls. So it's legal now, you know? So we have like these beautiful wall murals everywhere. People from all over the world come here just to see that. And I figured there was a space to kind of share the stories of people that kind of like I went to high school with in the 90s and 2000s and share their story on, you know, where this movement started here in Miami to where it is today, currently legal. And these guys, when they went out in the streets, they were doing it illegally, risking their lives, you know, putting their family in jeopardy and things of that nature. And now we have people like wall muralists and things of that nature that get paid to do these things.
Wow, that's nice to hear. Jason, how much was the pre-production doing? Because this seems like a lot of work. The pre-production to gather all your ideas to put it together there before you go into production. How many hours you spent doing there? How many research? How was that? Tell us a little bit about. I'm interested in your documentary. Actually, how was that?
So the first thing I have to say is that this is a zero budget film. So I did everything from start to finish by myself. So it took me in total to get to from pre-production to completion was about a year and a half because I did it all myself in my free time. I actually have a full-time 9-to-5 job that I had to focus on. I have a family with, you know, two kids and a wife and a dog and a picket fence and all of those things. So I had to kind of put everything, you know, put it together in the time that I had, you know, late night hours and things like that. Mm-hmm. So as far as budget, there was none. So, you know, it was just my time and my passion and my desire to see this film come to life.
How was the production time? The production time, how do you manage that to get the interviews, the footage? How was that process? Tell me.
So the process was interesting. And I reached out to one artist, the very first artist I reached out to on through Instagram. You know, I approached him and I said, hey, listen, I want to make a film about, you know, wall muralists or painting. You know, I at the time, I didn't know that there was a difference between a wall muralist and a graffiti writer. The graffiti writer was this guy that I spoke to, and he kind of schooled me in the process of, hey, you know, they're two different things. You can't, you know, you can't put them together because they're not the same. And so he taught me that. He introduced me to people in his, what they call a crew. I'm sorry, I have
no worries.
Interruption here. Let me turn this off.
So you were talking to this graffiti guy, right?
Right. So I spoke to him. He introduced me to people in his crew, what they call a crew, the team of people that they go out with, and they paint walls together and they hang out together. And from there, it kind of just sparked. And so he was my first interview. And then I realized that I work in an advertising agency. It's my 9-to-5 job. Mm-hmm. I work with people that were well-known graffiti artists from the 80s and 90s in my office. So I had access to them easily. All I had to do was approach them and say, hey, would you be interested in being a part of this? And two of the guys said yes. So that included, now I have three people that I have under my belt that I can interview and talk to. And I happen to know these guys pretty well. So, you know, that worked out. And from there, other people saw what I was doing and they wanted to be involved. So they actually reached out to me. I didn't even have to search for them.
Wow. How long was that? Do you remember the production to get all those interviews for each?
Sure. By the time that I finished, I had 5 interviews of graffiti artists and 2 interviews of wall muralists, because at the time I didn't know what direction I wanted to take it in. Do I want to do wall muralists? Do I want to do graffiti writers? So I had 5 interviews plus the 2, and it took me about 6 months to get everything done. Yeah, get everything in the can.
So do you edit the film yourself?
I edited the film myself as well. Yes, edited. I also taught myself motion, like animation and 3D, not 3D, but just motion work. So I never did that before either. And you'll notice that in the film, you'll see some 3D animation, some, you know, things like that. And so, I edited. I did some of the graphics and things like that. I did have, at my disposal, because I work in an advertising agency, one of the guys helped me out to create some of the graphics as well. So that was also a plus, but the majority of everything I did on my own.
What about the final cut? How do you decide what's the final cut? Do you get feedback, you show it, or it was your own intuition? How was that?
No, yeah. I definitely shared it with others in order to get opinions and thoughts, and you know, and to the point where I said to myself, if I don't stop this now, I'll never end it. I will continue just making changes and changes and changes and changes. And to be honest with you, I'm still making changes. Because I every time I watch it, I find something else that I could either fix or make it a little better, or, you know, things like that. But I definitely had to collaborate with people that have never seen it, just so I can get their input and from the public. And you know, every time I did show it, it seemed to go over really, really well. So at that point where everybody was like, okay, yes, I think you got it, that's where I said, enough.
Jason, where about the music? We all know more or less how the music is going to work in your film. I mean, but how do you manage to get what you want in music? Tell me.
So that in itself was a whole other animal. So to score, and the entire film is scored to music. So there's only small breaks where there's no music and very little. So that's an hour and at least an hour and 10 minutes of straight music. Mm-hmm. I happen to be able to connect with a musician, and this musician was just starting out as well. His name is Alex. And he said, you know what? I want to help you with this project. I need, you know, to put my name on something, because I'm just starting out. And so what I will do is I will help you curate music. So we got a stock music site. He was able to kind of curate music. We went back and forth. And then he's also a composer. So there's certain segments that he composed music specifically for different parts so that it fits and goes within in the film.
Jason, let me ask you, I got 3 more questions. Let me ask you one, which I always ask to the directors. Would you rather to have an editor, or you would have edited yourself? What do you think?
That's a tough one, you know, because the editing process is the most important process. It's the hardest process, the most tedious process, and, you know, in the most time consuming process. Yeah. I would love to have an editor, but if that were the case, I still think I would have my hands involved with the editing, because it's just so like tied together with the story. Right? Yeah.
Yeah.
So yeah, I mean, I would definitely say yes to an editor though, because I've learned so much this go around. Again, this is my first film. Mm-hmm. That if I had a budget, I would definitely get an editor. I would definitely have a sound guy. You know, I would try to build a team to right. work with me and collaborate with the whole process. Yeah, because it's too much for one person.
No matter what you say, you done good, man. You did it great. So congratulations. Hey, Jason, thank you so much for your time. I appreciate it. Are you coming to Barcelona, man? Come on.
I wish. I want to. But, you know, let's see what goes on. If this vaccine works and they say we're clear to travel, you know, to other countries, Barcelona is one of the places that I want to go to.
Right,
yeah. I'm going to do everything that I can.
It's going to be a lot of connections, a lot of filmmakers we have from Miami that are willing to come over. So, yeah, reconsider, buddy. Nice to talk to you, Jason. Thank you so much for your time. I appreciate it, right?
You too, Darren. I mean, I really appreciate you, and I appreciate the festival for selecting me. Thank you.
Thank you. See you, Jason.
All right. Take care.